Bueno, vamos a comenzar. Muchas gracias.
We will begin. Thank you for being in the session so late in the afternoon. This panel is going to be in Spanish, how to reinvent market capitalism. Please feel afraid because we won't reinvent it just as Sarkozy did and he didn't do very well. We will try to rethink capitalism in Latin America. We have Alicia Bárcena with us. She is the Executive Secretary of ECLAC, the Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean. She was head Chief of Staff of Kofi Annan, and she has long experience in sustainable development. We have Mr. Larraín Lascurain. He has experience as a Minister of the Economy of Chile with Sebastián Piñera, and he now works at the Universidad Católica Chile. We have the Director of IDEA, expert in parties, elections, democracy, and governance in the region. We have Mauricio Lazala, Vice Director of Business and Human Rights Resource Center of the UK. He worked in the International Criminal Court, and he's an expert on the impact of companies on human rights. Leonel Dominguez, he's a president of Global Democracy and Development Foundation. He has a long experience in Dominican Republic. He presided over it for 12 years. Everybody has it clear in their minds. Latin America has astonished the world for several years because the growth rates were unprecedented. There was poverty reduction. There was a huge optimism because inequality was reduced year after year. There was important spending. Great investments were done in education and sanitation. The most unequal region in the world could change and change its history forever and recover lost decades. But what has happened now, and we've seen it in previous panels and debates, it didn't have the necessary momentum. This wave of reduction of inequality and change of extreme inequality that existed in Latin America stopped before its due time. Raw materials prices were affected, and we didn't get as far as we wanted regarding reducing inequality in the world. What I wanted to ask you was to begin with our conversation. We've seen that support to democracy is dropping in Latin America. Many consider that this is due to the crisis. This economic model, can it be sustained due to this, with this inequality? So let's start with you. I really think that inequality is one of the big scourges of Latin America and the Caribbean, above all because inequality goes against development, growth, welfare, security, and everything. But it's inequality which is not income inequality, which is the one that we measure at ECLAC. The rates are above 0.5%. But we are also referring to functional inequality, the distribution between capital and the salary mass. That is to say, income or profits go to capital rather than to people. And third, concentration of wealth. In Mexico, 80% of financial assets and non-financial assets lies with 10% of the population. The Gini of wealth concentration is 0.7. And global inequality has created a feeling of losers, a class, a majority group, which is disappointed. Disappointed with globalization and with this economic model because it's unequal. It is not true that we have more growth or more trade. And besides, we also have a crisis, which is the most serious failure of all, which is climate change. And it's an emergency that is there. Environmental degradation exists. So there is a style of development which is not sustainable. I don't know whether it's going to be the future of capitalism or of what, but if we want future to exist, the development style must be changed. Felipe, do you agree that this is not sustainable? Partially. One should have a certain perspective a long time, and perspective in time is the following. When we say this model, what do we really mean? Please forgive me. because I will now put on my academic hat. Let's reflect. The world has known economic growth for the last 200 years out of 2,000 years of existence. This coincides with the Industrial Revolution and the emergence of capitalism. Before this happened, the world hadn't grown. Since the times of Christ, year zero, and 1500, growth is zero. Zero per capita income and population do not grow either. Secondly, I fully agree that we have an issue with distribution. More than 25 years ago, I published a document regarding inequality. It showed how countries that are not as unequal have a trend towards growing more. But within, because we should take a look at the complex side of the matter, as well as the half that is full in the glass or the bottle, we've had a reduction of inequality that has not been redressed since the last decade. The figures that I am dealing with, globally speaking, there is no regression. We are the most unequal region in the world, it is true, but in the last decade and a half, because this began early in the 2000 decade, in my country and in other countries, inequality was reduced. And there was a period in which this did not happen, around 2008 or 2009. And then the process continued. Now we are in a situation in which we are facing the end of the commodities supercycle in the region. And this forces us to reinvent ourselves. To analyze matters, we have to make a difference. Latin America is very diverse. We have countries that took advantage of the supercycle to improve economic institutions, autonomous central banks, and also fiscal agencies. They accumulated resources in good times, and other countries squandered them, just like Venezuela did, or Ecuador. I've been visiting Ecuador lately, and I've realized how, from the good times of oil, nothing has been saved. Other countries have done it. So we have different realities. Nowadays, the countries that are better positioned in the region are those that belong to the Pacific Alliance. And I'd like to make a caveat with Argentina. Things have improved importantly regarding quality of public policies. So I think that the idea that the model is not suitable, let us be specific. What part of the model are we referring to? And also, we should consider that although distribution is extremely important, it is not the same how, for the sake of the reduction of inequality in distribution, negative policies have been implemented in Latin America. They are fruitless. There is no future in these policies, because if you stop economic growth in a country through the lack of a tax reform, of course that's going to go against you. I had to implement two tax reforms. I have no problem against increasing taxes. There are reforms that are well implemented and others that are not. If you want to improve on inequality, we have to act on education and quality of education. And I would like to conclude with an important figure. In Chile, we are in the middle of an unequal, so to speak, region. But when we divide the population into cohorts that have to do with ages, the young have an equal distribution, which is similar to the one of the OECD. And the adults also have an important inequality in education. So maybe the most optimistic aspect of all this is that as much as we have improved education, we've incorporated more people to the education cycle. Let's say that tertiary university is at around 35% of that age group. It has doubled and tripled in the last 20 years. So as much as we have achieved that, we've improved inequality. And this is not an overnight change. You should not think that something is going to be done and the following day it's going to have permanent and positive effects on income distribution. It takes time. It cannot be done overnight. But where are we going? Is the model sustainable? Is becoming more complicated and society can finally demand an alternative model? First of all, we have to distinguish if it's a specific economic situation or a model as such. If it's a model, we should not restrict it to Latin America, but market capitalism model at a global level. In the specific case of our region, we should see that there are some positive aspects or elements that are related to the fact that because of the crises that we have experienced in the 80s and 90s, there are some things that we've done well. Macroeconomic stability has been recovered. Tax prudence and the capitalization of banks has been recovered, the supervision of banks also, as well as a prudent or cautious fiscal policy. There are some internal aspects that were favored because when commodities prices increased, Latin America was already working stably from the macroeconomic point of view. When the 2008 crisis unleashed, first of all, it was not originated in Latin America, but at the core of world capitalism, the US. It then spread onto Europe through the toxic assets via the subprimes. So no bank went broke in Latin America because of this crisis. But it Latin America was affected by the drop in the world trade. So does the increase in the prices of commodities, which grew for a decade 5.4% of an average annual growth, that's spectacular, the golden era, is that sustainable? No, it is not, because it did not depend on endogenous players, but rather exogenous, extraordinary player. China was growing at 12.5% annually. It deaccelerated and it started growing by half. So therefore, the Latin American commodities demand was reduced, prices dropped. And as Felipe said, if a country in good times was not able to invest in other productive areas, diversify the economy, of course, then the virtual collapse situation ensues. So the economic situation as is not sustainable. The model aspect must be debated from a different point of view. Mauricio, as a representative of civil society, how is this seen by companies? Up to what extent is it sustainable seen from the civil society point of view? I believe it is not sustainable. The barometer of trust, the Edelman barometer of trust, says that the levels of trust in the private sector are at a critical level, which is very low, and they've been going down for 5 years. So as not to repeat myself, especially about the negative effects of inequality, inequality is undoubtedly one big factor regarding the lack of trust of the people as a whole regarding institutions and private companies. But there are other factors. For instance, the factor that has been mentioned widely, which is the revolving door. From the point of view of the public, there are balances and regulations or checks and regulations that could regulate that phenomenon in which big businessmen go to politics and politicians go to companies and they use confidential or insider information to make their own interests advance or progress, and the people feel at a disadvantage. Another factor is the lack of social dialogue. We've seen that in many of the biggest infrastructure projects in Latin America, no attention is paid to the opinion of the communities that will be affected by these projects. And this undoubtedly contributes to the lack of trust. And lack of transparency is an important factor, too. There are countries in which regulations, decisions are more transparent and are accessible to all. There is a higher level of trust and equality because people have access to the information and that information can be used to improve public and private policies. So this lack of trust leads to the emergence of populist movements. They are in its heyday, especially not only in Latin America, but also in the North. Populist and nationalist movements take advantage of these feelings to exploit marginality, and people feel that globalization has left them aside or behind. So if we want to stop the growth of nationalist and populist movements so that they don't bring backwardness to globalization, that should be based on a globalization with clear rules of the game, we should take a look at the root of the heyday of these movements.
But what can be the consequences of such an idea taking root? Thank you, Carlos. I'm not going to summarize the last 2,000 years, but I am going to summarize the last 40. Why do I believe that this is important? We have to look at this not as a snapshot, but rather as a video. Where do we come from and where do we stand? We don't have much time in the region, so we started transition to democracy in the 70s, early 80s, and next year we're going to have 40 years. But we can't tackle it. Let's take the region as a block. We have the first cycle, the first economic cycle that is related to the political cycle, the lost decade in the 80s in economic terms, that is, the debt problem. But that's when the region begins to experience in the 12 years from 78 to 89, 90, with the last entries, Nicaragua, Paraguay, and Chile to democracy, 90s. The first 7 years were years of neoliberalism, the Washington consensus, that was okay, 3-point-odd, and then we had the Asian crisis, the half-lost decade, 98 to 02. That lost decade is when all the neoliberal governments were deflated. They were the ones that had led the privatization process in Mexico, Cardoso in Brazil, and Menem in Argentina. Those last three presidents are the ones that introduced re-election in Argentina. Everybody believes that it was Chavez. No, Fernando Enrique Fujimori and Menem introduced it because they said, listen, we're doing so well, we can't leave. They reformed the constitution and they introduced the possibility of running for office again. When we discovered that we were in a crisis, China comes in, and then we have the boom of raw materials. We go from 2002 to 2008. We see a growth in the region, and that's when we have the Lulas, the Kirchners, the Correas in Latin America. We already had Chavez, and that's when we paint South America pink. And with a new left. When we are again celebrating of 2008, 2009, we were scared, nothing happened. 2010, we have a leap upwards. We grow to 6% in 2010, and when we're uncorking the bottle champagnes and we say, okay, we got scot-free, well, then we have 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and with the last 2 years, with a recession. And today we are feeling the patient for any pulse, and maybe we will grow 1.3%. If we grow at 3 or 5%, it will take us 15 years. If we grow at 3, 24 years, 1 or 2 points, it won't be sustainable. We have to add to this that we're having 18 presidential elections in the next few years. Between 17 and 18, we'll see where the region is headed. There's correlation between the economic and political cycles and the external sphere. We started talking in 2015 that there was going to be a new political science and an an economic cycle of deceleration and unrest. But as all the elections were lost by officialism, Kirchner here, the officials in Peru, Chavez, and parliamentary elections, etc., it was believed that the Latin American region was headed in the right direction. But then Ecuador comes in. We are going to have Chile, we're going to have Honduras. They don't play a very leading role, but we have to pay attention to 2018. There's Mexico, there's Venezuela, if there are elections. Colombia comes in, and Brazil, in addition to Paraguay and Costa Rica. But those four mega elections, plus the Chilean one, are going to decide what the course that Latin America will take. So the core issue here is we have to continue to support democracy. It's still 53, 54, 55%. What has dropped is the satisfaction with democracy. So we are not talking about a crisis of democracy, but a crisis in democracy with political unrest because of insecurity, corruption. So how do we help the region not to fall into populism? Because if we don't pay attention to the demands of the new agenda, which is a middle class agenda, we will fall victims to our own success. Chile has fallen victim to its own success. They decrease poverty, and there's a new society with a new with new demands. They demand more and better public services, more transparency, more accountability. They want everything now, and if possible, for free. And that, of course, is very difficult. I'm going to tell you, as a matter of fact, I believe that we've made big progress in the institutions, in macroeconomy, etc. But where do I see the problem lies? It's in the generation of public goods. I believe that society has become too individualistic. I live in Chile. In Chile, people has solve the problems behind doors. They run into debts. There's an emerging middle class, which we call the satisfied majority. They say, OK, don't make waves, don't do anything, because my kid is at school, I have my car, I have my house, my TV set, my table, everything. But when they go outside the door, there's nothing, there's no public goods. Those collective goods that a society that is more inhabitable should have, they are missing, they're lacking. So what is happening? The political state, the political rights of people to go to vote, etc., are not translating into a social state or status. You can see that Chile has made great efforts to bring people out of poverty. But these programs are aimed at extreme poverty. What we do not see is the social pact, I believe, that is necessary, a new social coalition that would make life much easier. I talk to young people a lot. I don't think that young people like the world we're leaving to them. It's a very complex world with problems, with equality, with sexual, with gender equality. So how do we install certain state policies that would lead us really to create a more understanding, a more collective society? That is what is missing. We should leave aside our individualism because it's affecting us. It's having its impact on us. So public policy should devote itself to trying to revert to a more inclusive society so that wealth, and we are capable of generating wealth, okay, humanity can generate wealth, but not at the price of the environment or destroying whatever oceans or biodiversity we still have. So how would we distribute the wealth in society? I believe that's what we have to care about, distribution of wealth, income, opportunities, means, inequality has many faces. That's what we have to look at. Women, descendants from Africa, indigenous peoples. This is what the continent has to think about. Okay, so everybody's talking about Chile. Let's see, we're talking about a new social contract. I'm going to give you a piece of information. The Latin barometer believes, says that between 2004 to 2011, the perception that governments are working for the whole country, but this indication goes down to 22% in 2016, which is the lowest figure in the last few years. So many people are already thinking that we are not working for the people. The new social pact, do you think it is possible in the current situation? With a complex situation, can we invent a new social pact in Latin America? I believe we can. I am optimistic about what can be achieved. Even in this period or these times of where the super cycle is ending, when you have extraordinary circumstances, the most important decision that you have to make is, how do I benefit from this? How do I set the basis to be able to use it in time, to utilize it? And it's going to be now and not in future generations. Every country is different in this sense. I agree with Alicia in one of the things she mentioned, and that is the environmental challenge. I believe that that is a very important issue, and many people want to deny it. I'm in a UN Council that deals with this topic, and it's something that is of great concern, that the leading nation in the world should try to deny the environmental issue is terrible. When you lose power, but up to a certain point, and when you say that Ecuador in a certain way is proving that the trend will not continue, and if the election is 49-21% and it's in the electoral college, and they're saying that there was fraud in the elections. So I believe that this reserved prognosis that of what happened in Ecuador, well, it makes me have doubts. I believe that populism is something that we cannot say or give any specific definition. You chop a head off, but then you believe it's gone, but then it crops up again. It is a danger that we are facing. We are the ones who invented populism. That's what we did in Latin America. Populism, as we know it, appeared quite a number of decades before. So in Argentina, it was a thing. And he was a champion of populism, Argentina was. But I believe that what is the best way to stop populism? You have to show people results. If you tell people and you preach and there's no results, well, you have a problem. But I believe that those countries that are, particularly in our case in Latin America, we have so many natural resources. We have to have good institutions, because otherwise we won't be able to fight populism, or it'll be more difficult to resist the battling of populism. That's one aspect. Also, from the point of view of our societies, we have to be more solidary, and solidarity has to be stimulated too. When we wonder why they are not challenging this model in the United States, well, there are the cases of Bill Gates, for instance, who donate most of their fortunes to charities that will help the world. And we don't have a tradition for that in Latin America. That's one thing that we should have. We should be more solidarist, more of a philanthropist, so that this can happen. And these panel discussions will generate discussions and debate. But I want to take one point, as you mentioned, and it refers to the fact that one of the problems we have is that entrepreneurs become politicians. I beg to differ, because in this country we have a businessman who went into politics and now is the president of Argentina. I had a government was a big businessman, and he is running for election again. And I'm not an analyst, and I'm not supporting this person, but I'm referring to former President Sebastián Piñera. What we have to do is to deal with the conflicts of interest. It's not the problem if the person was a businessman, but how do you manage the conflicts of interest? And this is the case not only with big businessmen. There are people who don't have that much wealth and still have a conflict of interest. It's not the problem that a businessman is going into politics again. So the point is that we should have a clear idea about conflicts of interest and the use of, for instance, privileged information. So when we can establish trusts and deal with institutionality, we'll do much better.
The problem is not that politicians become businessmen and vice versa, but the lack of checks and balances and regulations about how the information is used when they come to their new positions, the conflict of interest and rules regarding conflict of interest. But the perception of the people at large and society, there is an implicit conflict of interest because there isn't even a period of cooling down, leaving the position in a company and becoming a politician and vice versa. So it's rather how that revolving door is regulated than the revolving door per se. We see it clearly in the US. It's not a problem of the Latin America alone. It has existed for a long time, and it has contributed to the lack of trust in institutions and in companies. That's why I was making that reference. Yes, President, you also wanted to say something about Trump and the effects this might have on this continent and the reformulation that existing in the United States. So this continent can also see a stage or a time for reformulation, that people prefer to go for a new protectionism. There are many things to clarify. The most important economic phenomenon of the last years has been the global financial crisis of the year 2008, which has become a big global recession. In 2009, in Latin America, we experienced a general downturn in growth, but there was a reactivation in 2010. It dropped again in 2011, and since then up to now, there hasn't been recovery of growth in Latin America. That is the effect that international trade has had. There's been a drop in international trade, which has brought about lower income for Latin American states and therefore a reduction in investment. On the other hand, in that specific situation in which the economy is not rebounding since 2011, that is going to have an electoral effect. The incumbent that had to face a situation of an economic squeeze simply loses power, whatever party, whatever ideology they belong to. If the right party governs, the election is lost. And so the same thing happens with the left. But in some cases where there has been a certain recovery, such as the case of Spain, when Rajoy reached power, there were, of course, street demonstrations. And that is where Podemos and Ciudadanos emerged from. But in the times of Rajoy, Spain couldn't solve the economic situation completely, but it improved. Rajoy's work brought about an improvement in economic situation. He was not a complete winner in the first round, but was above the other candidates. The ballotage didn't make him a winner either, but there had to be a way out. No new parties, not Rajoy, so there's a third round. And let's take Evo Morales. In the referendum, I had to be the head of mission by UNASUR. Undoubtedly, the economic situation in Bolivia today is not similar to the one that existed 3 or 4 years ago. Evo loses the referendum. Why? Because it wasn't the way it was before, but it's not so bad. We're not at the brink of collapse. And Venezuela, legislative elections, December 2015. The opposition claims that the government has everything, controls the media. The members of the National Electoral Council are Chavistas. The army is also Chavista. There was no adequate electoral environment for democratic participation. But what happened? The opposition controls and won everything, controls a majority in the National Assembly. Why? In spite of the political power that Chavistas had. Why do they lose the elections? Because Venezuela was at the brink of economic collapse. This brought about social discontent. No government can contain that, no matter how repressive it is. So there is an economic situation, social discontent, and resulting elections. In the case of Ecuador, Felipe, I presided over the OAS mission. They seem to be quite even. The first round, they lost. They did not get to 40% by 0.06%. And they could have made it. The person visiting Ecuador realizes that there's a transformation. Roads, highways, airports. There's a remarkable infrastructure work. It can be perceived clearly. But in the last 2 years, from 2014 onward, these are the critical years in Latin America. Social protest in Brazil started in 2014. The same thing happened in Venezuela. Political turmoil in Latin America go back to 2014. And if there are elections, the incumbent will lose. That it happens in Latin America and in Europe. François Hollande does not dare to run for election. There was no re-election. First time in which a French president decides not to run for a second round of office. Why? Because he knows he's going to lose. Probably Lepron will win. Nobody expected him because the two others, Fillon and Lajoupe, have been sort of burnt. And there is a reaction against having Marine Le Pen win. So the phenomenon we're witnessing is unheard of. We're not talking about economic determinism, that economy automatically imposes itself. But these are crucial factors. The economic situation is a result of a severe crisis because G20 never coordinated an adequate policy. In Europe, there's austerity, austericide, as they call it. In the United States, there is an increase of public spending to stimulate growth and reduce employment. If the big powers in the world have not come to an agreement, the crisis has not been overcome. But if you allow me, I would like to talk about the viability, sustainability of the model. I was making a reference to the last 12 years. The model, which is the global model, market global capitalism, is unsustainable, and I will explain you why in a second intervention or at some other moment. I'd like to ask Mauricio, could you please explain the consequences that the Latino barometer has published, because there are people in Latin America who increasingly think that there is no government focused on them, on the people. Apparently something is going on, according to what has been explained about the change of cycle. Which are the consequences that could exist? Where can we go because of this? The problem is not only inequality, but social and economic uncertainty. This has also been mentioned in another panel. We are at a historic moment, the best to be the consumer, but the worst to be a laborer. And undoubtedly, with your phone, you can consume, buy whatever you want. You can have something delivered to your door or have a car being sent to your door in 5 minutes, but the driver of that car won't have a job in 5 years' time because that job is going to be done by an autonomous car. So globalization and markets should improve the majority and not the minority, as is the case now. So if you allow me, maybe we could talk about the solutions. This panel refers to rethinking capitalism. I had thought about a few items, some points that deal with future solutions. So we'll leave that for the end. Daniel, consequences, political consequences of this feeling that's becoming more ingrained. I'd like to make myself clear. We had three cycles, three economic cycles with three political cycles. The region clearly cannot go back to the 19th neoliberal cycle, and it cannot either keep this level of spending because the economy cannot weather it. But it is not clear for us the future direction of the region. In Ecuador, what I said was that it is the first election in which this chain of defeats of the running party stopped. It stopped by a minimum difference. It's been challenged, but it stopped. And we must wait for the four big elections of 2018 and the midterm elections with Macri in Argentina to see the direction that the region will take. I do not see going back to neoliberalism just like in the 90s. There are no political conditions for that, but I do not see the possibility or the financial sustainability of continuing spending at such a level because bonanza is no longer existent. Where are we going to? We don't know, but there is a fundamental clash between expectations and realities. That's the insatisfaction of progress. The most important thing governments should do is have the capacity to manage, to run the revolution of expectations. We've taken 70 million out of poverty. They are in the middle class, the vulnerable sector, and it's been empowered. We've said, you are citizens just like everybody else. You have the same rights. We've made them become useful to consume with high indebtedness, but with high degree of consumption. And from the political side, we have to say, sorry, 7 million are now back into poverty. And UNDP says that there would be a risk, if things are not done correctly, that between 25 and 30 million people will go back to poverty. Politically speaking, this cannot be accepted in many countries. And it is not so, because in many cases there is no leadership and there is no quality in institutions. We have a crisis of representation, weak political parties. This rule of law is also weak. We cannot face this issue. Institutions have been designed in the 19th centuries to run extremely complex 21st century societies. And I agree with Larraín, we have an issue that is pending. We won't come out of this situation with an economic reform. It is necessary, but it is not enough. We must accompany it with a state reform so that there is good public policy, a tax reform, a deep tax reform, to have a good fiscal situation, and also a very deep political reform. Without the political, economic, and state reform and tax reform, the region will suffer social conflicts and problems that have to do with governance. And I'd like to conclude by saying that that's the core issue. We must recover a story, because governing is not only administering. Sometimes economists are autistic, and they always speak about economic indicators. That's why we have Trump, Le Pen, and many others. We must convince people that there is a sense of belonging. People must be convinced that they are part of something, that they share a destiny, a future. That's why we must think in a disruptive manner. We cannot have disruption in the economy and in technology and be gradual in political institutions. This is a mismatch. We must be disruptive, politically speaking, too. So I believe that the change is so deep, not only in the region, but also in the world, similar to the Renaissance. Not only those of us who are here, but in the next 15, 20 years, very deep changes are coming along, and we don't know how to deal with them.
I believe we have some minutes left. If we could have, we could entertain questions. Otherwise, we will continue debating. I'm a member of the capital market in Argentina, and I want to make a comment. In our region, we've always been characterized by the capital flight, and then at times of bonanza. So it's very difficult to build a region in a country where there's no investment. So what is distributed is only fiscal deficit, never wealth. So people believe that truly there's no response in democracy to this problem. The problem is iterated over and over again. You don't have to go back 2,000 years, but 150 will suffice. This is a region, as old immigrants used to say, this is a wealthy region with lots of natural resources, but sometimes they come here to steal things and then go away. Of course, politicians adapt to the circumstances of the time. Right now in Argentina, we've undertaken a deep change. There's a law in capital markets that is trying to change that course. I would only like to hear a response from the panel. Why hasn't capital flight always ever been considered with the fact that big companies that should be reinvesting in the country instead of exporting their assets, their benefits, and the only thing that is left in the region is misery and poverty? As former Minister of Economy, and you've already, I'm sure you've suffered the capital flight. This is a major problem in Latin America. It's something that can be perceived here in Argentina. There's a huge operation with respect to that. I would like to mention that we have the reverse phenomenon. We got a lot of capitals flowing in at the time that I was in government, and then we had a problem with the appreciation of our money. We had problems with agriculture, with industries, and they were threatening us to do things against us because the rate of exchange continued to fall. But I want to say something. You have to be realistic when it comes to capitals. We cannot be naive and say, as some countries do, that, okay, let's increase the corporate tax rates, do that, and capitals won't fly away. No, this has been documented in economy. This is the case in Europe. If you change that tax, the country next door will do the same. That's why I'm sure there's some admirers of Piketty here. And that's the problem that he has. He wants to increase taxes, but he's intelligent. So even though I don't agree with him, he's very capable. He says, OK, all the countries in the world should come to the same conclusion and agree to change that tax. In Chile, we call that like a day that will never come. But to conclude, I believe that we have to have that dose of realism. One final thing that you were mentioning. The truth is that this is one of the most complex issues that we are facing, and that is the middle class. The new social reality that emerges out of the success of having taken like 70 million people out of poverty. They are empowered, they have strong demands, and the problem is that if you give them everything they're asking for, that's where we'll have economic explosion. I believe that the role of leadership and responsibility is very important. And you don't only have to preach it. If you say, you're asking me for gratuity, and I will give you gratuity. In my country, there's $4.5 billion. And we have a problem, because if we were Norway, then they would tell us, OK, there's that in Norway, but there's a lot. There's like more than $100,000 per capita. We do not have to exacerbate rights over our duties. Everybody now wants to know where are my rights. That clashes with the most elementary problem. You have to tell people what they can get, but what they have to give back. That's where leadership and responsibility comes. We cannot promise what we'll not be able to deliver. I don't know, Alicia, if you agree with the idea that those who ask too much, well, they're part of the middle class. Okay, is this middle class destabilizing the system because of what was mentioned before, because they're asking for more than there actually is? Do you agree? Definitely, I believe that to ask for more rights, well, that's the way ahead. I believe that the 2030 agenda that was recently passed by the UN is indivisible, universalist, and that should be our horizon. I believe that we have to get there gradually, but I do not want to leave aside the agenda of rights. Entitlement is about the thing that we have to think about when we are rethinking capitalism. And we have to reconsider it in several ways, the distribution of work and capital. We haven't mentioned one thing, that is the future of work. The fourth industrial revolution was the topic of an analysis, and it said that if people continue to look for work, we will need in 2030 70 billion jobs. There's going to be robotization, automation. So there's a change in the paradigm. I don't believe that the paradigm, as was described by our friend Larrain, is the one that I would like to find. The paradigm that I want to look for is to get a more equitable distribution of technology, education, work. And we have to fight for an industrialization, for a horizon of productivity that is not extractivism. I understand Chile, because Chile obviously depends on copper. But what we have to look for is greater production expansion. We have to incorporate 143 million young people that we have in Latin America and the Caribbean. The 30 million, 20 of the 30 million migrants that were in the United States, for instance, or went to the United States because they were expelled from our countries. So this agenda 2030 is proposing a horizon of progress. Getting 75 million people from extreme poverty by the year 2030. Can we do it? Of course we can. But because if we say, oh, no, we can't, there's no money. What do you mean there's no money? Secondly, we have to give electricity to 23 million people who in Latin America still don't have electricity. We have to create new coalitions that are political and economic to gain this. So what is the gist of the whole thing? We have to change the conversation between the social, with the private, the public companies and society in order to get to a better country. Yes, I understand, but I just want to tell Alicia that, of course, we have a discrepancy. It's not that I am against the 2030 agenda or people living better or diversifying or giving them electricity. The difference is in the mechanisms that we are using. Okay, you talk about diversification. Okay, but how do we do it? And secondly, I do not agree with promising people what we cannot deliver, because that's demagogy, and that tends to populism or paternalism too. It's not what you're offering them. When you tell people, okay, you're going to have these things, and it's going to be for free, and that's not the thing. You have to be responsible. You have to decide what you're going to do, that you're going to do this with the available resources. But of course, the ministers of the economy, their role in general is saying no, because if they say yes to everything, they're not good ministers. There was a minister in Spain that said that it's the only thing that you cannot negotiate. President Fernandez, to conclude, your final conclusion and any proposals for the future that you may have. I would conclude by saying that this is the worst time in history to be a politician, because politicians would face two tragedies. The first tragedy is that they're going to lose the election, and the second one would be to win the election, because after you win it, what are you going to do? There's a series of ideas that were mentioned here. Alicia said so very eloquently, things that we can do to overcome the extractivist model, how to improve productivity, competitiveness, the quality of education, how to give better public services that are of quality. All of that is fine. My concern is that if, Alicia, we advance towards such an horizon, it means that we started from the basis that we are facing a crisis. And that's what we are facing, indeed. And that is the problem. It's not just that the economic situation that we have experienced since the golden era cannot be sustained, but the thing is that the model of market capitals cannot be sustained since the 80s as a result of the deregulation of the financial system. What has been prevalent has been the financing. The financial system is no longer an intermediary in between investment and savings. So the global financial capitalism is like a casino. And the result of that is that the assets at the global $700 trillion is three times the global output of the world. So when you accumulate such level of wealth and that is not invested in the productive, in the production sectors, but rather is falls prey to, I believe that my main concern is that Donald Trump is doing that. Donald Trump is reverting the Dodd-Frank law of finance. He opposes to the economic
Wow, that was quite a comment. So in order to conclude the idea, it's not sustainable. How can we turn it into a sustainable model? There are some young people in the back who want to ask a question. OK, so he can conclude, and then there will be questions. We have to be innovative. We must be creative, disruptive. It is true that one has to be realistic, but we also have to be innovative. And we should not be naive, of course. There's a debate going on in the world about a universal basic salary. That was quite naive and idealistic 10 or 15 years ago. But now Finland is implementing it, and it is testing. And we are personalizing it for Latin America. And Latin America should try this, should debate these ideas, new ideas, with all the disruption that's coming along with the crisis that all panelists have mentioned. And companies must be more public and vocal about social issues and environmental issues, and not only economic aspects. Some people will say, but that is not the role of companies. Companies don't have experience or knowledge about giving opinion on environmental or social aspects. Of course they do if they want to. They have the resources to develop that experience. And many of them are doing it already. And there are some studies by Harvard recently showed that there are CEOs that take this position are then benefited due to the consumers and clients. That goes against what many, many businesses believe. When Tim Cook, Apple CEO, took his public position or took a public stance defending the gay and lesbian community regarding a bill that was being passed in Indiana, many people said, don't talk about this because people will stop buying iPhones. It was completely opposite. And there are different surveys that show how CEOs who took public positions about climate change and favoring more progressive policies regarding climate change and environmental protection have been benefited, economically speaking. So it isn't only ethical or moral, but it's also business. These things get together and have a positive result. So let's think about activities, positions, new ideas where we can bring public and private spaces together, together with a social dialogue in which the interests of the private company are on an equal footing than society interests. So let's have a question. I'm Gabriela Enriquez. I'm part of the Young Global Leaders. And my question is related to the solutions that you know that are working well. It's a convention. There is a convention about the importance of rethinking work, rethinking the future of those who are self-employed, of having incidence on the capacity of generating income out of our own work. And there is also a need for the creation of massive and disruptive models and gradualism or a gradual approach as an institution. Institutional approach has not been so positive as it was thought. And UVIs sometimes have been challenged. What the initiatives that you know of that bring together wealth creation in the region and reconsider how wealth is distributed so that the models that have to do with extraction of wealth creation are restructured. Globally, there is not such a commitment, but regionally speaking, we have to do all this in a democracy, and that is no minor fact. Implementing these changes in a democracy implies that every 4 years or 5 years, we will have to subject ourselves, or in Argentina every 2 years, subject to asking the electorate whether they agree or not. That electoral cycle has to have the correct dimension. We do not have the possibility of implementing big changes without living in a democracy. Democracy implies commitment that has to do with restriction and the electoral also restriction too. But if you take a look at this in a perspective, this sometimes cannot be extended a long time. And millennials also consider the same thing. We cannot have disruptive leaps on the one side and politics inching along. There is a big trust crisis, and there is a lack of correlation between what's political and changes. Basic income, which was incorporated in the new constitution in the city of Mexico, that is a debate that is taking place in Brazil. It has taken place in some parts of Canada, in Finland, and other Nordic countries. That is something that should be considered seriously. Why? Because we will have to see that up to now the solution was employment. But in the future, apparently, not everybody will have an employment, or employment won't be enough to finance a certain standard of living. And fundamental, you cannot have citizens belonging to class 1, 2, or 3. You must find a better level of inclusion or social cohesion. I was surprised when I was watching the Davos video. We had Ms. Lagarde from the International Monetary Fund, and she had two messages. What does Madame Lagarde say? She says, if politicians do not hear now, they do it. Pay attention to what's happening, because consequences will be serious. Secondly, growth is not enough. Paying more taxes is not enough. Creative solutions must be found. There is an awareness that we must find, not in an irresponsible or naive way, but we must not be gradual in our approach. We must find creative solutions. Society is clearly demanding more urgent decisions and more daring or challenging solutions. Thank you. Very clear is that we have lots of challenges. The situation is very complicated. We all agree that this won't last much longer. So we must work in order to develop these ideas. Thank you.